Macmillan Audio presents Lead from the Outside, How to Build Your Future and Make Real Change by Stacey Abrams. Read for you by the author. This program was previously published under the title Minority Leader and includes a new preface. From Mom and Dad, Andrea, Leslie, Richard, Walter, and Janine, Jordan, Faith, Cameron, Ryan, Aaron, Devin, Brandon, and Nakia. When I dare to be powerful, to use my strength in the service of my vision, then it becomes less and less important whether I am afraid. Audre Lorde. Preface to the paperback edition. On November 16, 2018, I officially ended my bid to become the next governor of Georgia. Although Election Day was November 6th, we'd gone into overtime due to the closeness of the vote and irregularities in the process. Folks were already grumbling because I'd broken with political tradition in a late election night speech, demanding a continuation of the process of counting votes. I had the temerity to refuse to meekly accept the results without question, because that's what protocol demanded. But my life and this book are about knowing the rules and then deciding if they apply, or if we need to write our own rules. When I first wrote Lead from the Outside, I was a few months into my campaign. Each day as I typed out chapters, I did so between calling donors, delivering speeches, knocking on doors. I did so knowing that in the process, I created an early chronicle of what would be the hardest challenge in my life. Georgia voters had not elected a Democrat to statewide office in more than 15 years. And the last time the state gave its electoral votes to a Democratic nominee for president was 1992. No woman or person of color had ever made the general election ballot as the gubernatorial candidate. The campaign I envisioned had been crafted out of years of experiences as a legislator, an entrepreneur, and a civic activist, all of which would be called into question. In my calculus, the scrutiny was a small price to pay. Our next governor had the potential to make an immediate, meaningful impact on people's lives. As I told my team, if we begin by believing every vote matters and always demand that our leaders work for us, then we can expand what is possible in Georgia and, by extension, across the South. A good government should be a tool that helps where it can and gets out of the way when it should. It must work for everyone, protect our investments, and defend the civil rights of all. From my time as minority leader, winning the job during the last redistricting period, I knew the next governor would also have the power to veto maps and set our political landscape for decades to come. Georgia has a fast-growing, ethnically diverse population, and by 2026 or so, will be the first majority-minority state in the Deep South. As governor, I could ensure our state maps accurately represent the diversity of the state and give a voice to every community. My victory would also be an historic one, the election of the first Black woman to serve as a governor in the United States. Almost daily, I parried questions about the significance and symbolism of my bid. What did my run signal for people of color, for women, for a new generation of leaders, for women of color? My answer evolved over time, but the core remained the same. I had an obligation to build a coalition of voters who reflected the diversity of our state, our nation. I would run a campaign that began with growing the civic power of Georgians, a power I would ask them to use to help me lead the state. Simply by winning, I would redefine our belief in what leadership looks like. In May 2018, I became the first Black woman to receive the gubernatorial nomination of a major party in American history. On November 6, 2018, I received more votes than any Democrat in Georgia history, outpacing President Barack Obama and Secretary of State Hillary Clinton. I learned later that our campaign tripled the turnout of Latinos and Asian Americans, more than doubled the youth participation rate. I received more votes from African Americans than the sum total of Democratic voters in 2014. My candidacy created a path to win a congressional seat and flip 16 legislative seats. I received the highest percentage of the white vote recorded in a generation. And I was within 1.4% of the man who had run the election and run against me, serving as both contestant and referee. So, on the night of November 16th, I returned to my initial mission and to the thousands of people I'd met along the campaign trail. Though cliché, nothing is more profound in the act of running for office than actually talking to voters, especially those people who are too often left out of the conversation about the future. When called upon to accept that the results of the vote would not give me the victory, I accepted the math. But when told to perform the traditional dance of concession, I vigorously declined. Well, I knew that, according to the law, I had to tell my fellow Georgians their jointly imagined future would be delayed, I refused to play my scripted part, because the game had been rigged again. This analysis isn't new, nor is it news. For those of us on the outside, the quest for power is always rigged. Sometimes it's because we don't know how to gain entry, or because the winners get to play by a different set of rules. In elections, our nation has fought a lifelong battle about who gets to have a say in the outcome and set the terms of the next battle. Race, gender, and class have been constant markers of access, beginning with the Constitution. My election was no different. Poor communities found themselves without equipment for voting, including missing power cords and antiquated machines. Other voters arrived at their polling stations only to be turned away because they'd been illegally purged or because the poll workers didn't have enough paper for extra ballots. Some stood in hours-long lines while their compatriots had to give up and go back to work or risk a family's already meager paycheck. This is how the game of elections gets rigged. In my non-concession speech, most political folks expected me to turn a blind eye to the complaints and the outcome. They were looking for me to say that no compromise of our democracy had occurred, and most expected polite compromise in the language I used to call an end to the fight. But unfortunately for them, I'd read my book. And I understand conceding the election would not be right. I admit the playing field is never level, and the reality is that a number of us enjoy a degree of privilege over another at various points. Yet knowing a truth does not make it correct. Right and wrong remain valid, real constructs, and the 2018 Georgia elections crossed the line. And I said so, on national television. I held myself accountable, as leaders must, even when the result would be snide comments, angry op-eds, and unreturned calls from former friends. This was a question of right and wrong. What's not right is giving credence to bad actions and thereby becoming complicit. That was true on November 16th, and it will be the crucible for each challenge I will face in my life and every challenge you will face in yours. There is right and there is wrong, and it's important to distinguish between the two in every choice, in every hard moment of decision. Do we concede? Do we compromise? Or do we fight? These are the options. Concession accepts an act as right or proper, and society's existence necessitates the act of compromise, of bending our wants to the needs of others. Leadership is a constant search for the distinction between when compromise is an act of power and when concession masks submission, or when the fight is on. I know this election demanded a moment to be uncompromising, to build a future without conceding my principles. I refuse to be gaslighted into throwing away my power, diminishing my voice, because I don't simply speak for myself. I had the hopes, dreams, and demands of 1.9 million Georgians standing with me, and thousands more who had been unfairly, unlawfully silenced. And whether speaking up is about an unfair election or a flawed system of workplace promotion, the obligation remains the same. Once we recognize that wrong exists, we must fight to change it every day. When I first wrote Lead from the Outside, I wanted to deconstruct the successes and failures I had and distill them into potential guidelines for others. More, I wanted to rethink how we cast everyday challenges into such distinct categories. From discussing my personal debt or my brother's constant struggle for sobriety and freedom, my mission was to shake our internalization of false narratives about who is worthy of opportunity. As an intensely private person, writing this book served as a dry run for office, where every foible, decision, or gaffe would be recast into a 30-second commercial questioning my humanity and fashion choices. Colleagues who'd known me for more than a decade had never known about my brother's incarceration, and customers of my companies learned about my business acumen and my silent ownership stakes. I remain intensely private, but I understand the fragility of the distance I'd maintained for so long, and that is likely a good thing. In the middle of the campaign, standing in line for tea at the airport, a server from the restaurant next door charged up to me and wrapped me in a bear hug. I racked my brain to identify him, but instinctively, I returned the embrace. Turns out, we'd never met. But when the stranger let me go, he smiled broadly. "Thank you," he said gruffly. "I owe student loans and take care of my mama. Thanks for telling folks the truth. We're people too. You've got my vote." Again and again across the course of this marathon, Georgians of every stripe would grasp my hand, hug me, or bust my cheek, whispering their truths to me. "My daughter is just like your Walter. God and I love her and we believe in her. I'm broke, but I'm a good person. I want to run, but I thought I had to wait my turn." Over and over, I realized that candor, whether in the pages of this book or on the trail, transformed stories into lived truths, shared by those who would never know their common bond. When I traveled across the country, I found the same repeated. Our narratives are singular, but not unique. Understanding how my story liberated others to tell their own, I understand more why I wrote this book in the first place. It's the same reason I refuse to back down about how unfair our elections process has become and the danger it poses to the democratic experiment that is America. I have to speak up because silence is not only dangerous, it is corrosive. When we refuse to name our obstacles, we can never find a way around them. Worse, we accept their inevitability, believing we deserve what we get. I also wrote this book to be the outsider's version of the art of war. Only this time, we're fighting for our rightful place at the table, in the boardroom, and eventually in office. Thus, I took my own advice and turned my rage and pain into action on November 16th. Not only did I refuse to concede, I created a new organization with the mission to guarantee better elections for those who follow. With my next steps, I will leverage anger into fixing what I know is broken, and in the process, show others to be resilient in their battles for the justice they seek. With the constant reminder that the battle will be hard, marked with defeats, and I may never be the direct beneficiary of success. Those who pick up this book to hate read and find reasons to reaffirm their low opinion of me will be duly rewarded. They will read this book as a rejection of the normal order. As I said that night, I'm supposed to say nice things and accept my fate. As outsiders, we are expected to continue on as the system commands, primarily to preserve our ability to participate. And just maybe, one day, win the lottery of opportunity to be the one who slips inside the door. I fully recognize the process and how effective it is. My problem is, I don't like it. And I believe we can fix it. Not simply by dismantling what has been carefully constructed by centuries of patriarchy, racism, classism, and bigotry. No one has that kind of time. Instead, we have to hack it. Figure out its flaws, identify backdoors, and overwhelm the system. Consider this my call to arms. When I wrote Lead from the Outside, I asked myself what I valued in a leader, what excited me about the work I'd done across sectors and communities, and at different moments in my life. Leadership requires the ability to engage and to create empathy for communities with disparate needs and ideas. And that's why, as outsiders, we can make the best and most effective leaders. Telling an effective story demands a similar skill set. Good storytelling takes the reader into a life that is both familiar and foreign, enough of both to make space for others to feel empowered to tell their stories. I know the lessons I set out to share and the values I sought to advocate remain true, perhaps even more so. I could not have gotten through the last year of my life, through the grueling 10 days after Election Day, if I didn't know what I was fighting for, waking up for, speaking out for, flying across the country for, raising money for. Greatness demands purpose. In the face of upended expectations and extreme setbacks, even more so. I have faced the toughest loss I can imagine, and I know I will lose again and again, but I will never fail to try. Introduction. In November 1994, I entered a hotel room.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.